Okay, so we've got about 10 minutes.
We've got about 10 minutes. Well, one of the things that we thought we would talk about is, so some of you may know that there's something called the AI 100 project. What that is, it's a 100-year study on artificial intelligence. It began in 2009, and the idea is, in fact, to study the progress and innovations that are happening in artificial intelligence. It's composed of a group of us who are on the steering group, which is mostly research scientists working on at the forefront of AI, who've been collaborating. It's based at Stanford, but the researchers are from everywhere, from MIT, from Harvard, and a few other places. And one of the things that is part of that project is the AI Index project, which is, in fact, a project to try and track and actually measure the actual progress. So I thought we would talk about that because Jack is actually one of the founding members of the AI Index team. I joined much later, but we're now part of that team and we're working together on it. But Jack, how would you describe the AI Index project? What are we trying to do?
So the Stanford 100-year project, quite ambitious. It's running for 100 years. The AI Index is trying to provide a yearly readout of data about how AI is progressing, how it's impacting society, and how we are detecting the symptoms of AI affecting the world through quantitative data. So it's really an exercise in trying to, earlier today I asked you all if, you know, AI is an industrial revolution. The AI Index is designed to try and get quantitative data points to let us reason about whether this is or isn't the case.
So last year was the first report of the AI Index. So just recap roughly the kinds of things that we measured.
So the sorts of things we measured in that report were a mixture of technical measures and also things like employment. We would look at employment websites in a variety of geographies and look at the job listings that required machine learning or AI. We would model those growth rates over time. We'd also try and break this down into more specific geographies as well to give you a sense of the societal impact of AI and its impact on the economy, and we produce technical metrics. Now, what's changing this year is that we're going in two sort of directions. We're going more international, so we've been doing collaborations with other places abroad, collaborators in Germany, collaborators with the JRC, which is connected to projects that the European Commission does, and collaborations with Tsinghua University in China to try and get that international data. We've also tried to get data about diversity in AI, which is actually kind of challenging. Like, we know that AI is not hugely diverse, but finding quantitative data that can show that has itself been a challenge. But the hope is that once you have this data, you can give policymakers better tools to plan and reason about these issues.
But there's also some very, very technical data that's in the index itself.
Yes.
Things like progress on machine learning, progress in machine vision, downloads of different tools. And so talk more about the actual stuff that's in the,
okay,
in the index.
So I describe the technical aspect of the index as like throwing darts at a dartboard that is attached to an animal which is running very, very quickly. So you have these AI progress metrics, some of which are good, like image recognition or speech recognition, that we can model over long periods of time, and others of which are harder. So we talked about language earlier today and the rate of progress in language AI. That's a difficult thing to model because languages are different in different geographies, and the metrics we're using to change them are themselves kind of altering on a yearly basis. So far this year, we've got new data about common sense reasoning and some of the elements of AI which speak to that advancement. And we're also working on data about systems that can perform more complex language tasks than before.
Right. And I think one of the things that's very cool about this project, and we hope to enlist all of you, first of all, this is a nonprofit venture. So it's not, this is just for the heck of it.
That we do this for fun.
Nights and weekends. But the part of the goal is to create a bit of a resource, I think, for everybody to have at least a place where you can actually see what's going on, what data sets are available. In fact, you could probably just go and look at the report from last year, but we're getting more ambitious, aren't we?
So the level of ambition we have is quite large. It's to help save the world and solve all of its problems with data. But I think it's good to have good goals. And so for 2019, a lot of what we're doing is building institutional collaborations. So we're going to shift from the index mostly being work done by the steering committee on our nights and weekends to that work plus work occurring in other institutions around the world, one of our roles will be to help broker contacts between different institutions and also be a resource for policymakers. So if you ask us about some data you want to track or you're wondering if there's data out there, we will probably have spent some period of time looking at this data and we'll be able to tell you if it exists and where it is, and if it doesn't exist, how you could go and create it to make our lives better. So that might be useful as well.
Yeah, and one of the gaps that we're finding in the data set, so when you look at countries like China, for example, or even parts of, say, Latin America and Africa, it's actually very hard to get data sets, partly because sometimes they're in different languages, sometimes it's hard to get access to the scientists. Well, it may be easy to go to Tsinghua University and get some data sets, but getting kind of data from across all of China can be quite hard.
Can I explain an ironic thing we discovered this year? So we wanted to understand what enrollments in AI classes in China looked like. So we wanted to go to the universities and get numbers of students in classes at the graduate level in AI, because we have that data for Stanford, Berkeley, MIT, and it seems useful to have for comparison. It turns out China has very strong data protection rules on student data. And so one of the bits of data you can't get from China are class enrollments for students at the master's level in AI courses in that country. And I think this highlights how we don't have like a connected global attitude towards what data we should be capturing. And it actually makes it really difficult to perform things like comparative country analyses. I think that's actually motivated Tsinghua to think about this problem and how they can go and get better data, because it's obviously an important tool for the Chinese government to know what their enrollments look like at that granular level.
Yeah, and then one of the things that's been quite fascinating, at least for me, is just the interest that this has generated from policymakers. I think it's hard to underestimate the fact that quite often policymakers don't even have access to this data. You would think that governments would know this, but they don't.
I mean, one of the tasks we're doing this year is we're just going to all of the major AI conferences like NIPS, AAAI, ICLR, other acronyms I could bore you with, and we're getting them to give us the data on what papers are being submitted by different countries, because there isn't an organization pulling all of this data together, and yet that's exactly the sort of data policymakers want to know, like how many papers are being published from my country in these specific technical areas relative to the other countries. So we're trying to produce that resource as well.
Yeah, and the thing that I think has been true historically, but maybe different going forward and will only get harder, is that I think up until now, I think it's fair to say most of the researchers in AI have mostly known each other, at least most of the ones at the cutting edge, whether they're in Germany or London or Toronto or Montreal or the Bay Area or even Tsinghua University. It's been a relatively small community at the cutting edge.
It's like 2 degrees of Kevin Bacon, if you know
that analogy. Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's quite easy when you talk, you suddenly realize they were advised by the same advisor and they kind of, but I think this one is going to get harder. So I think it's been easy for us so far to keep track of where the cutting edge is, but I think it's going to get harder going forward. So how would you, I mean, you know, we have this room full of people and we're about to wrap up here, but if we were to ask for one thing from this group, what would it be?
If you have any quantitative data at all, tell us. Because like most of this data is incredibly useful and it becomes more useful once you join it up. So if you have anything you've seen on a graph that has the word AI written above it, just let us know it exists. Because there's actually a good statistical chance that that data can be grouped with other bits of data to give you a greater insight than just that single graph provided you.
So this is all for a good cause, and hopefully you'll all benefit from it.
And it's a non-profit, so give us the data.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.